Hi everybody, my name is Pete Frisella. I'm a developer advocate on the Google Analytics team. Today I want to talk to you a little bit about content experiments, and more so advanced implementations, and some high-level information for you so that you can get implement content experiments and really take advantage of the platform and the flexibility it offers. So to get started, I'm just going to go just quickly around what are experiments, why are they important. We're going to look at some basics of implementations, and then we'll go into some details of examples and provide you a little bit of tips at the end. So let's start with experiments. What is an experiment? So when you think about Google Analytics and the kind of user interaction model, typically you have users that are arriving on a property or a site. You want them to do something, and then ultimately you want them to reach some kind of goal. So if that's the objective, experiments are really a great way to test changes to make sure that those changes are actually providing better performance for your site. So for example, increasing revenue or maybe time on site, these might be some objectives you have for your website. Or property, and content experiments allows you to test any changes you're making to make sure you're really making the right choice and implementing the right variation. So why Google Analytics for content experiments? There's a couple reasons why. I think the greatest benefit right off the bat is that you have all this user interaction data already, and you can add experiments now. So you have it all in one place, you get a great set of reports, and you can segment based on experiment visits and things like that. So it's just really having it all in one spot and having one kind of platform to do everything. The other thing is we've introduced this multi-arm banded experiments. There's a lot of resource information on exactly what this means, but just from a high level, why this might be of interest to you or why you'd want to use this. Typically, it's a little bit more efficient than A/B testing, but at the same time, it's just statistically valid. And then in many circumstances, the answer will come to you a little bit quicker. So the whole point here is that you're reducing the time for the experiment to run, but to come out with an objective that's actually performing better. So you're reducing the cost to run an experiment. You can imagine if you have a variation, you might implement one or two different variations, and you actually might have one that doesn't perform that well. And you really want to minimize that particular variation. You don't want to be sending visitors to a variation that's not doing well. You want to reduce that cost, and multi-arm bandit is really great for that. And then finally, our platform, it's very flexible because we have APIs. It allows you to implement it many different ways. And so you can do things like server-side experiments. You can also do experiments in non-web environments. So this is pretty unique, and it's really powerful and gives you the flexibility to kind of to match up what your business requirements are with what your objectives are. So to get started with experiments, there are a few things that you need to have in place. The first thing is really you need to have obviously Google Analytics implemented on your property. Once you have that up running, that's kind of the first basic step. But you need to make sure you have some kind of goal or objective for your property. That could be a user-defined goal, so you might set something up yourself using the admin or management configuration. You can also use predefined goals that we have set up for experiments. So for example, we have things like you can optimize for minimizing bounce rates or increasing page views or time on site, things like this that are already predefined for you. And then you want to know what the variations are, what the changes are you going to make that you want to test. So this is pretty fundamental to the whole experiments process, is that you need to know, are we going to increase this font size or change this button color or maybe introduce a new algorithm? So these are all different variations of things that you might want to test. So let's get a little bit more into the implementation basics, and this will kind of set it up for the examples that we have later on. When you look at how to run an experiment, there's typically five steps you're going to go through, regardless of the platform or regardless of what the actual objective might be. The first thing, as I mentioned earlier, is that you have to define those variations. So what are you going to test? It could be a whole bunch of different things. It depends on your environment, what's important to you, and what your objectives are. Once you've defined those variations and you've decided, okay, we're going to change this landing page to look like this, we're going to have four different variations, then you want to go into Google Analytics and configure the experiment. So where step one is kind of is outside of Google Analytics, something that you have to do on your own using whatever system that you have, whether it's a content management system or maybe you're just coding it yourself. Number two is where you actually go to Google Analytics and configure it. And that means like setting up the URLs or variation names that you're going to use, the kind of traffic coverage, things like this. And this is all configured within Google Analytics. And then once that's set up, you actually run the experiment. The next thing that happens is when a user comes to the property and is exposed to the experiment, then you need to choose the variation. So for this particular user, if we're going to include them in the experiment, what variation should we show them? And there's a couple ways to handle this. Google Analytics, the standard implementation, takes care of this for you. And then for more advanced implementations, it's up to you to make these decisions. But we provide the APIs and the tools to really help this step. And then, of course, it's important, are these newer returning visitors? And that's going to affect your variation choice. Once you've decided which variation to show them and you've actually showed them the variation, then you need to send data back to Google Analytics to indicate this. So what experiment are we talking about and what variation did you show that user? And this gets sent back and is actually part of the pipeline for processing and will end up affecting your reports. And we'll get a little bit into that later on. And then finally, the fifth step to kind of any experiment is the outcomes or the reports that you actually can view to see how it's performing while it's running, and then ultimately like what the outcome of this experiment was, which variation won, was there a winning variation, and how did the other ones perform. So this is really obviously the kind of the objective or outcome you're trying to get here. And then from there, you actually do the implementation. If there is a variation that's won and is better than the other ones, then you can implement that one at this point. So I thought it'd be good just to go over the platform today and then see how Content Experiments fits into the current platform that most people maybe have seen or are familiar with. So when you look at Google Analytics, the way it works, the way the platform is organized, we kind of have these big areas. We have collection, so that's kind of the measurement of user interactions. That gets logged, and then we do some processing. And the processing is affected by the configuration that you have set up. So if you have goals or filters, that's done in configuration and will actually ultimately affect what your reports look like. So you have this nice pipeline, and let's see, like, where does Content Experiments fit in this? So it's somewhere around here. It's kind of its own statistical engine that sits but interacts with all these different components. So when you think about the steps that we talked about earlier, the first step where you define your variations is outside of GA, but the second step where you configure your experiments is now interacting with this platform. So there's really two main ways to configure the content experiments. One is through the web interface, and the other one is through the management API. The third thing is we want to choose the variation. So this particular step involves, depending on what environment you're working in, if you're doing web, we provide a library. It's called the Content Experiments JavaScript API. And this library takes care of, interacts directly with the Content Experiments interface. And it allows you to kind of use this all these tools through JavaScript, and it makes it really easy to interact with the service. If you're doing non-web environments, you can still get this the choose the variation, but it requires you to go through the management API. And the management API allows you access to all the different experiments that you're currently running, and it provides you the information you need to make this decision. So, for example, what variations do I have for an experiment? Which ones are active, and what are the weights for those particular variations? All that information can be obtained through the management API, and that's the information you need to make this variation choice. Whereas on the web with the library, you basically just say, using the JavaScript library, get what's the current variation that I should use for this particular user. So it's a little bit more simple on the JavaScript side, but equally you can do the same thing from the non-web or server side through the management API. The fourth step was what we wanted to send experiment data to Google Analytics. So once you've chosen a variation and you've shown the variation, we need to make sure that data gets sent back to Google Analytics. If you're doing web-based experiments through the browser and you're using JavaScript, you can use the we have Analytics.js and GA.js, the two libraries for tracking or measurement, and you can send data through those interfaces. And the way it works is you set the variation or you that you've chosen. Or you're using the JavaScript library, which will take care of this for you. And then that data gets sent along with hits that you're sending through GA.js or Analytics.js. So they're kind of attached to those particular hits. If you're doing non-web or server-side, then you want to use the measurement protocol. And this allows you to interact directly with the Google Analytics service through HTTP requests. And that allows you to send hits from pretty much anywhere. And then finally, we have the outcomes or reporting. So when you look at the platform and this model, that fits in on the reporting end. And again, you can pull out data through the core reporting API. We have some dimensions and metrics exposed through the core reporting API. And then also you can obviously use the web interface to look at reports. And then from an outcome perspective, if you want to know which variations have won and the status of an experiment, that's also available through, obviously, the web interface. But you can also query that stuff through the management API. And this allows you, when you look at this, the management API and what it enables, you can bring all of the functionality of experiments to different environments. And that means creating them, monitoring them to see where they're at, and all these different steps and even reporting can be all basically done outside of the interface if that's what you're trying to do. OK, so we have an idea of kind of how it all fits together. Some of the important things you want to consider when you're running an experiment, there's kind of different attributes that are going to affect what libraries you should use, whether you should use the API, management API. So the first thing I typically look at is, OK, if you're going to run an experiment, are you going to be doing this in the web, on the web, like in a browser? Or is this going to be a non-web environment? If you're doing web, then again, use the content experiments JavaScript API, the library that we provide. It really simplifies things for you. If you're doing non-web environment, then definitely use the management API. It gives you access to all the information you need to make these decisions and run an experiment. The second thing is storage. So when you think about how an experiment works, when the user is exposed to an experiment, at that time, we need to determine, OK, have they already seen this experiment? If they have, then let's just show them the variation that we previously showed them. And to do that, that means you have to store some kind of state somewhere in terms of like this particular user looked at this variation. On the browser side, it's fairly straightforward. We provide the library, and it takes care of all that for you. And it uses for Google GA.js, it uses cookies to do this. If you're doing a server-side implementation, then you may be able to store stuff on the server for every particular user, or you can also use cookies yourself if you're doing a web-to-server, client-server type integration. But it's something to think about, like, will you be able to store this information on the client side, or will I have to manage this all on the server side? And obviously, the server side one's a little bit more complex, because then you need to maintain for every user which variation they've been shown for an experiment. And then you also need to store the details about the experiment on the server side. So we'll get a little bit into that later on. The other thing that is configuration. So are you going to use the web interface, which is a little bit easier to set up because it's visual and you can go through the flow. But we also have the API. So if you want to do an integration where the experiment is created outside of GA, then you would want to use the API. If you're going to use your own statistical engine, then you would actually need to use the API to create the experiment. So these are decisions that you know, the choice you make is going to depend on what you're trying to do. So, if you are using your own statistical engine, then definitely API. Otherwise, you can use the web or the API. It's up to you. And then, yeah, optimization engine. You can choose your own if you want to do your own optimization. You know, flip a coin, whatever it is. You actually have the ability to do that with this platform. Otherwise, you can use and take advantage of the Google Analytics multi-arm bandit, that approach. And you can definitely try both and you know, whatever you prefer to do, we provide the APIs and the information to do that. So, and then lastly is the variation choice that you're making. If you're doing client-side, definitely I would recommend, again, from a browser, use the JavaScript library. Otherwise, you're going to be making choices on the server side, then you need to use the management API to get all the experiment data. And at that point, you need to do things like determine whether the user should be included in the experiment, also determine what the current active experiments are. So this is all done on the server side. And we have detailed guides on how to do this on our developer site. So I'll get into that a little bit later. So let's look at some high-level implementation examples. And the whole point of this session here is really to talk more about high-level steps that you need to consider when you're implementing some of these more advanced implementations for experiments. We do have two solution guides that were published recently. One is on content experiments without redirects, and the other one is running a server-side experiment. So this video really complements these two documents, so I recommend that you check out these two solution guides. They really go into the details on how to do this stuff, and they provide some code snippets, and they really explain all the steps that need to happen to do most of this, most of the experiments. There's just a few things from like a implementation perspective that I'm going to talk about now that really doesn't go into details, but if you read these docs combined with what I'm talking about today, You should be able to basically implement pretty much anything that you'd like to do regarding the content experiments. So definitely check these two documents out. We'll provide links later on for you. So there is kind of three other integrations that, or three implementations that people have kind of asked me about that aren't necessarily covered in specific details in the documentation. And there's a few little things that you need to do to make all these work. So let's go through them. One of them is CMS integration. So if you have a content management system, it'd be great to actually integrate this experiments right into that system. So how would you automate this process, right? If you think about content management systems today, typically you know someone's sitting there writing some new content or making a change to a page. Now, when they make a change to the page, if you have Google Analytics set up and you have objectives, it'd be great at that point to then offer that person the option at that point to test this change before it actually gets published. So this doesn't work for every change that you're doing, but certain things that are significant that you're making these, you're making significant alterations to your site, and you really want to see, is this a good change, or is this going to be effective in terms of improving our goals? So it'd be great to have this kind of flow where the user edits the page, CMS offers the option to test the change, and then the experiment runs. And then you actually don't publish anything until you've concluded the experiment. And if there's a clear winner, and you can test multiple variations of this change, then you can actually publish and finalize that change after you've already determined that it's going to improve the objective or maximize or minimize what you're trying to accomplish on your site. So this would be a great flow for any CMS vendor, or if you have an in-house one that you want to provide this functionality to your users with in-house, definitely this can be done. And I'll kind of go through now what the steps would be to get this accomplished. So if we think about those five steps that you have to go through for kind of an experiment, the first one is defining the variations. So this is, I mean, for CMS, this is great. CMSs are really good at defining variations. You can just add new pages and new content. And that's pretty much taken care of through this interface of the CMS system. And then you need to configure the experiment. So this can be all done through the API. So you can imagine you would create the variations in the interface of the content management system. At that time, it would ask you if you want to run an experiment. And then you would use the management API to create that experiment in Google Analytics. And there's a few things that you want to do here. And this is kind of what people don't always are usually asked me about, and what I let them know is that when you create the experiment using the management API, there's a property, or argument that you can set that's called editable in GAUI. And if you set this to false, it will prevent the user from going into GA and changing that configuration for that experiment. And you might want this because you're going to manage it all through the CMS system, and you want to disable that specific functionality so that they don't go in and stop the experiment early or make changes because you've set this up through the API. And that prevents any changes in the UI from happening. Then the other thing you want to make a decision around is the serving framework. And I'll get into this in a sec, but redirect or API. So what does this actually mean when we talk about the serving framework, right? And when you create it through the API, this is something that you have to set. By default, it'll be redirect if you don't set it. So what does this actually mean? Setting the serving framework to redirect is basically what you would get if you created an experiment through the web interface. This is kind of like the standard implementation. And this is where you have this Java script snippet, and you place it on your original page. And what happens is when the user visits that page, it redirects them to the URL that's been chosen for them, or the page that's been chosen for them, the variation. So when you look at it through the API, when you create an experiment through the API, if you look at you list the experiment, you'll see there's a JS snippet property of that experiment. So this is kind of like a helper property. It gives you this JavaScript code that you would want to use for this particular serving framework, and it provides it, and it fills in the ID for you automatically. So if you looked at the response from the management API for a serving framework that's set to redirect, you would basically get the JavaScript code that you would have seen in the web interface. So it's that same JavaScript snippet. If you set it to API, the serving framework, then you end up with a JavaScript snippet that's more intended to use when you're creating the experiments outside of the web interface. And it provides you with this helper JavaScript snippet that you would want to use as part of your implementation in the content for the content experiment. So those are the kind of two differences. You could actually set redirect and use the JavaScript snippet from the API one. It wouldn't make a difference. It doesn't actually affect anything else. It really just changes that snippet for you to really just give you, it's just a helper for you. So once you've decided on that, the next thing you want to do is you have to actually choose the variation for the user when they visit the experiment experiment page. So if you're doing redirects, so the CMS system can actually just use the redirect method, and they would just provide, so you'd want to just add the snippet to the page when you render to the user, and it would take care of the client-side redirect for you. It would basically act the same way as it would for the web interface implementation. Right? If you're doing an API implementation for content management systems, so now you're handling everything yourself, there's a couple of things you would need to do. One is you're going to be making the choice server side. So that means you need to query the management API, understand what variations are active for this particular experiment, and then you'd have to serve that variation to the user based on the weights that you have for that variation and whether they should be included or not in that experiment. And this can be all done through the management API. And then you'd actually want to show them the variation that you chose them chose for them. And then you need to just store on the client side. The way I would do is you'd store it on the client side in a cookie what variation was shown to the user. And at that time, when you've rendered the page to them, you would include the JavaScript snippet on the page so that you would set the chosen variation. Right. And then finally, you want to send the experiment data. And again, if you're using the redirect method, that snippet will take care of everything for you. It's the same as the web interface. If you're doing the API, then you want to use that JavaScript snippet, and you want to specify the chosen variation for this particular user in the particular experiment. And the way you do that is you use the set chosen variation method. And this is all documented in our solution guides and actual code that you need to do this. So definitely take a look at that. And then finally, we want to monitor the experiment as it's running. So in the CMS, you can imagine you'd have like an admin panel. The user would visit the administration panel, look at experiments that are currently running for their site, and see if there's any outcomes. And when there is an outcome, if there's a winner, then you would want to give them the option at that time to publish that particular experiment. And this can all be managed outside of GA through in the CMS itself as a plugin, maybe for WordPress or things like this, that you can actually create a plugin that would handle all this stuff. OK, so another thing people ask me about is the statistical engine if they want to use their own. So we do touch on this in the solution guide a little bit, but I thought it'd be good to cover it again because there's a few things that maybe aren't clear in the solution guides since they cover a little bit different scenarios. So let's talk about this statistical engine. So again, if you're doing the statistical engine on your own, the defining variations is still the same. You're going to use it either maybe you're using a third-party optimization platform. Maybe you're using a CMS system, or you're doing the variations yourself. But ultimately, you create different variations, and you want to run an experiment. So you would configure the experiment using the management API. And in this case, it's actually required that you use the management API to create this experiment. And that's because you need to set the serving framework, which we mentioned earlier, to external. And when you set it to external, it'll actually disable the multi-arm bandit. And then you can run your own experiments, and it won't actually affect anything in the reports with related to what multi-arm bandit would have normally done. And then again, I think you want to set the editable in GA to false, because I don't think you want the user to go in there and change settings. But again, this is up to you depending on your scenario. But because you're going to be handling this all yourself externally, you might want to disable the GA UI. So sending it to external, what actually happens then is it disables the engine for multi-arm bandit. When you look at the experiment itself, the variation weights that are listed as part of the experiment will still be there, but they'll always be zero. And they won't get updated, because typically what happens is twice a day, the multi-arm bandit, that engine will update weights for variations to determine whether or not they should be active, and also determine what percentage of visits should go to those particular variations. So that's disabled completely when you do external. Also, when you create the experiment, the objective or goal is not required. So you can set it to leave it empty, and it won't complain. Whereas if you set it to API redirect, the serving framework, and you try to create without a goal, it'll give you an error. And then the snippet, again, the JavaScript snippet that changes depending on the serving framework. Again, we provide this helper script that you can use if you'd like. And it just loads this content experiment's JavaScript library. So if you are doing a web implementation still, you're going to want to load this JavaScript to send us the experiment data. So again, if you're doing this, then the choosing the variation, it's you're in charge. So it's up to you how you want to do this, whether you flip a coin or whatever, it's up to you. But now you're managing this yourself, right, in terms of what variations should be shown. But you still need to send this experiment data. So we need to know, to get the reports populated properly, when you think back to the platform, we still need to know what experiment was the user exposed to and what variation did you show us. Now, you might have your own variation IDs if you're doing, so for example, if you're another third-party optimization platform, the user might have set up some variations and you have your own IDs. And then in Google Analytics, when you create an experiment, because you want to replicate it in Google Analytics, each variation is going to have its own ID, which is just kind of a zero index based, basically array or list. So the typically zero is the original, and then you have 1, 2, 3 going on. Those are, you can think of those as IDs for the variations. So when you send us experiment data to indicate the experiment and the variation chosen, you just need to make sure that the ID that we have in our system is the correct one for the variation that you've shown, because you might have a different ID in your system. So as long as those two match up, you just send us the variation data by using the set chosen variation method of their JavaScript library. And that'll ensure that all of the reports get populated with the experiment data. And then if you do non-web, then you don't need to worry about the JavaScript snippet. You can use the measurement protocol, and you can send data directly to us using HTTP GET request or POST, depending on what you're trying to do. And then, you know, you're going to conclude the experiment because you're going to decide when it ends or who the winner is. And once you've done that, you won't be sending this data anymore, and you can actually review the reports in GA though, and you can have all that data in there and do segmentation with user interaction data related to the experiment. So it works really well for we did integration with Visual Website Optimizer, and they're actually using this, and they're able to replicate experiments that they're running in their system in GA, so that you have this nice integration and you get these really great reports that are specifically tailored for Google Analytics users. It's great. Finally, we have non-web environments. So this is an interesting one. You can do things like kind of examples, like maybe like a kiosk, which isn't web-based, but maybe some other, it could be web-based, but maybe some other environment where you don't have the traditional kind of web model that we normally see. So again, you know, you're still doing the same thing. These 5 steps still apply. You're defining your variations. You might do even custom development to do that. But whatever you're doing, make sure you've implemented Google Analytics properly. So if it's non-web, that means most likely you're going to be using the measurement protocol to send hits to GA. And then also, you still need to have a goal and objective set up. So what are we trying to improve? What is the actual goal that we're trying to either maximize or minimize? So that still stays kind of the same. So you can use, in this case, you can use the web or the management API to set up your experiment, whatever is easier for you, and depending on how you want to set it up. When you do things like this where you don't have in the web interface where you create variations that don't really have a URL, you have to provide one still, and it's fine. It won't validate properly, but it's fine because you're just basically setting up the structure of the experiment in Google Analytics, and the URLs don't really matter. It's fine. And then you can still choose now at this point whether you want to use a statistical engine from GA or not. So if you don't, you can set the serving framework to external. So when you look at this, the non-web is kind of like the, you know, depending on what you're trying to do, it gives you all the different options you can use, whether you want to use this engine or not, whether you want to use, whether you're using JavaScript or a measurement protocol, you have the flexibility here. But you kind of have, you know, web might be easier for you, management API might make more sense. It depends on kind of your setup. What's important to really consider on the non-web environment is how you're going to store information around particular users and what experiments they've seen. So when you think about the client side, a user visits a website, Google Analytics has a client ID. We know that the visitor has been exposed to experiment, and we can store that into a cookie. So when they come back again, we know to show them the same variation that they were originally exposed to. In non-web environments, this might not be easier. There might not be a way to store it on the client side, so you might have to manage this on the server side. So this is really important for you to kind of determine early on so that you can set up your experiment properly. And then is it even applicable? You may have a kiosk, for example, where the start to finish is one user, and you're never expecting that user to return or do something. So the experiment really just runs in a single kind of session. In that case, maybe storage isn't important for that particular user. And then also, if you're doing this on non-web environment, you're going to need to make variation choices on the server side. And that means you're going to be using a management API to query the for experiment information. And you need to store that on the server side. And you probably want to do that at least twice daily. Because the multi-arm bandit, if you're using multi-arm bandit, it updates these values twice per day. So you want to make sure you have the latest experiment data. You would store that on your side. And then based on the variation weights in which experiments are active, you would make the choice on the server side. And this is explained in our developer docs on how to actually make these choices. So for non-web environment, we still need to extend experiment data. You always have to send this experiment data to Google Analytics. So once you've shown the variation to the user, then you would send the data with the measurement protocol. Right? So this will get the reports populated with the proper data for your non-web environment. So very similar, all very similar in terms of what you're doing, just little tweaks here and there on what actually needs to be done from an implementation standpoint. And then again, it's the same. You know, once you've got the experiment running, you want to monitor the experiment and then implement the actual winner on the kiosk or whatever it is for the non-web environment. Again, same as the other examples. Nothing changes there. So just a few tips. Additional questions that people ask a lot around kind of experiments and search. So I've had this come up before. So the big one thing people think off the bat is if you're doing client-side changes, that this might be negative. This SEO and stuff like that might actually affect it. So there is actually a great post by the Google Webmaster Central. They have a nice post that explains these different things. So I'm just basically using that information. But there are a couple things. So cloaking, when you're doing changes on the client side and changing the DOM and manipulating it, this won't be considered cloaking. So cloaking is when you're actually changing content just because you've seen Googlebot come by and you're going to change the content to because you know it's a search engine looking at it. That's cloaking, so you should never do that. But when you change the DOM and manipulate a page on the fly when a user visits it, it's not considered cloaking because it's not targeted at a search engine. So this is fine. You can do this on client-side redirects, or sorry, client-side implementations. Also, if you do have multiple URLs, you probably want to use the canonical. You want to make sure that you indicate which one's the canonical URL. And this will help for search indexing. And then finally, if you are doing redirects, make sure they're temporary redirects, so the search engine knows that this isn't permanent, and it'll index appropriately. And then finally, to reiterate the point of the serving framework, just make sure if you're using external and you want to use your own statistical method, you have to create the experiment through the API. There is no way right now to set the external set serving framework to external and disable multi-arm bandit if you're creating it through the web interface. So that's key to understand how to use your own statistical method. And then if you're using for serving framework, if you're using API redirect, it doesn't actually affect the experiment at all. It will just change the JavaScript snippet that's provided for you in the API response. So whether you use API redirect, it's up to you. If you are going to do a full complete integration, like a content management system integration, I just recommend if you're not doing redirects and just use set the serving framework to API, and then you'll get the correct JavaScript snippet for you. So one other note is that the universal analytics and experiments, so Analytics.js and Measurement Protocol don't currently support experiments, but it's coming very soon. So a lot of the documentation will be updated. And so once you see that updated, you'll know that it's available now. But all the kind of steps and process that we just talked about are applicable to whichever one you're using, but just so you guys know. And then a few resources. Again, there's the developer site for Google Analytics. We'll provide these links for you guys. There's a good experiments overview, and I think that's a good place to start. It provides all the links that we have available and all the documentation we have available for experiments. And then this video will kind of complement the existing solution guides that we have for redirects on the client side, or eliminating client-side redirects, and also running server-side experiments. So kind of this video combined with that will really provide you with a good overview of how to run advanced limitations for experiments. And then if you're interested more about the multi-arm bandit, there's a great article that's provided. I would go through the Help Center, and they really give you details of like how it works, why it's better, or why it's better maybe for certain situations, and really gives you some good detail on whether you might want to use that or not. So I think it's a great resource. And that's all for today. So I'd like to thank everybody for joining me. If you have questions, feel free to post them in the moderator. And I will definitely take a look and answer those questions online for you. So thanks again, and join us for our next Analytics Live, which we'll post on Developers Live. Thank you very much. Have a good day.